is a member of the committee conflict of interest for analyzing the implications of the indirect taxes on the accounting of conversion into IFRS, which the finance minister has been talking about. Yes, let the institute initiate on this. He is also part of the GST committee, constituted the SARC of ITI, to look into the research aspects of the transition question. He is a member of the Indirect Taxes Committee of Bangalore Chamber of Commerce and Industry and an author of the book GST Backgrounder, published by ITI. On a topic of CareBag in a transitionary mode, we have with us Dinar Badina. May I request Mr. Badina to come on to the dais. We thank Badina for accepting our invitation and being able to be here today. May I request Mr. Sanjay Gupta, the convener of the Banarbeta CP chapter, to come over and welcome Mr. Dinar Badina for this delivery of his address on audit under the Karnataka Bad Act. As you all know, VAT audit forum 240, including Mr. Maniyar Chakraborty, the information explanation submission and certification. There is a fair degree of clouding of non-understanding of the role of a chartered accountant when it comes to form 240 itself and the certification there too. Because it doesn't talk about an audit, it talks about a certificate. Right from that language to the audit and the requirements which are perceived in that is a matter of serious challenge. And to face this challenge, we have very nice to address you on this. Over to you.
Very good morning to all of you. Thank you, sir. Thanks for that introduction. A sunset lunch, Saturday afternoon. Condition there. Let me see how much of justice I can do and how I can keep all of you awake on this topic. Right. So, I mean, as I told, Karnataka, the audit under the KY laws, fine, we're not new to that. It's been there for quite a long time now, since 2006, year ending 2006 onwards. The first year was more or less as good as not there. It's only from the next year onwards that the audit really made some sense, right? But, you know, see, one thing I keep telling everyone is, before we start doing something, right, we need to understand why it is done. There are quite a few clauses in this so-called, you know, 240, form by 240, the format in which the audit report needs to be filed. There are quite a few clauses where, you know, I keep, whenever I land up talking to somebody, you know, the understanding or the purpose of that clause is never there. And not all of us know the purpose of that clause in the report. So, not knowing the purpose, definitely, I don't think we land up giving the correct details or the relevant details. Okay, I stand corrected, not the correct details, but I don't think we land up giving the relevant details there. So, let's then. The idea that I have in mind for today's discussion is to try and understand what is it that we need to disclose under each clause. Little time on that. And yes, there are quite a few questions around this topic. So as part of the slides, we have just put down a couple of questions there. I think about maybe 30 questions, which we have normally come across. You know, I thought we'll just put those questions and let's answer them also as part of the discussion now. Some basics. 31st December of every year is the due date for filing the VAT audit for the previous year, so long as the turnover. Now, turnover. It was earlier taxable turnover, subsequently it got changed to total turnover. So, even if my total turnover, not the taxable turnover, exceeds a crore, I will be able to file an audit report in Form Act 240. The penalty of non filing this, Not all of us are really serious about it because the penalty is very minimal. So 5,000 rupees, a flat penalty plus a 50 rupee per day. Not very alarming, so not all of us take it very seriously. Nevertheless, there is one additional penalty which can technically be levied, which we should be aware of, which is, you know, if it's a continuous default, it can refer, the case can get referred to DMSB, under which there is no precedent. I repeat, there is no precedent, but even prosecution can get initiated. I repeat, there is no precedent. Right? So, I don't think I will really end up using the slide, because in the slide what we have done is, each of the clauses we said what is it that we need to verify. But I want to keep the discussion in the manner of what is the purpose of each of the clauses. Right? Why should we disclose whatever we are disclosing? And you know, the common error, like if you pull up 10 audit reports and see, what is disclosed there is really not what is required. Right? So I share my experiences on those aspects with you. The first part of the certificate, right? If there are any questions, please interrupt me whenever. Right? The first part of the certificate, Form Guide 214, it reads saying, certified that I or B, being a chartered accountant or a master accountant, have audited the books of accounts. Now, are we auditing the books of accounts? Right? So what do we do about it? The very first sentence that we start with, it says certified that I have audited the books of accounts. But auditor is somebody else. The statutory audit or the tax audit, either way, is done by somebody else, one or more of the other people. Right?
So, can we certify an audited account?
No, I don't think we can certify an audited account. We can rely upon that and do whatever else we want.
The language of 240 starts with being certified.
No. That is the next part of this certificate. It says certified that we being chartered accountant. So, we are certifying that we are chartered accountant. Right? That is the irony of English.
No, but point is, the VAT audit can also be done.
By people who are not chartered accountants.
But they also use the same form.
They have to also use the same form, yes.
By default, you are confirming chartered accountants to everybody.
To an extent, at least within 2 years back, we could, when we are signing the hard copy of this report, we could change the language there. Saying you could remove the word chartered accountant and put a cost accountant or an STP as the case may be. But now when you are filing it online, and you have to submit the details online also once the audit report is signed. So there, you have nothing that you can really do there.
Is there something we need to represent to them to make the change in the...
Sir, my knowledge already represented. I mean, in the same breath, let me tell you, now that it is over, it sounds like a joke, but when a person is going through, you can understand, I'm sure you'll appreciate it. Suddenly, I see one report where, you know, there is one 240 online file acknowledgement, which says so-and-so person is signed, which is up from them. I was like, boy, I have never heard this client's name. So where did we sign the audit report from? 240. Right? So it was a case where online filing does not need a digital signature, unlike ROC or income tax matter. So this person, whoever that is, has just used the name and the membership number of this chartered accountant. That's all. So in my lifetime, I have not heard that name of that dealer. You know, a representation was immediately made through the BCIC for that, saying you please insist on at least a digital signature, or don't ask for that chartered accountant or the firm detail in the online filing, because it gives a very wrong picture to the department. Like, who is likely, see, today when the online filing has happened, not many bother to file a hard copy of that also. Not many of them really bother about doing that. So, as far as the tax office is concerned, it is what is there in their system. Right? So, fine. This is one more thing, you know, where even if an STP is doing, he has to certify that he is a chartered accountant. Though the hard copy can very well be different. I'm sure he would have corrected the hard copy readily any time. Right? Going to the next one. Certifying that we being chartered accountants, auditor the accounts, name and address of the dealer. You know, some basic details, very basic questions that arise here. We have to give the name and address of the dealer. So which address will you give? You are doing the audits for the year, say 13-14. You are signing the audit, say today, 6th of December, when there is a change in the office. He has changed his place of office, for which he has obtained the fresh registration certificate, not obtained, does not matter. That is irrelevant. But which address will you put here? The address which is related to that year or the date on which you are signing the audit report. Technically, it should be the date on which you are signing. Yes, of course. You are not saying during the year the office was at a different date, and that would suffice. For the year ending so and so, and that subject to our observations and comments about non-compliance, shortcomings, and deficiencies in the return. Fine. The certificate by itself provides for the caveated language, which all of us are experts in. Right? But where do you put these subject to? Where is the place in the 240 to put these comments on? The very categorically, the 240 says, subject to our observations, comments, and comments about non-compliance, shortcomings, and deficiencies in the return. Fair enough. There are deficiencies. We have observed that. Very good. There are non-compliances. We have noticed that. We want to report, but where will you report? In 240, there is no place which asks for these qualifications. In 240, believe me, there is. Within the form 240, which is a prescribed format, right? There is no place to put these qualifications. So what do we do? So what can be done is, there are a lot of details where, say purchase details, or say the sales details, various other computations that we give, which we give as an addition. So probably you can consider giving all your observations as an addition to the form by 240. Now, in the same breath, this part of 240, what I just read out, which is the first part, which is the certificate part, with those 9 clauses and a table below that, is what really gets submitted online also. Right? So, to keep the English correct, here you say subject to my or our observations, comments, and non-compliance, shortcomings, deficiencies in the return, say as referred to in lecture 1. Right? But you can't really type this as referred to in lecture 1 while you're doing the online filing. Does that mean the hard copy that you sign versus what is submitted online with the tax office to whom the report is made, to whom the audit report is made, is different? Right? So what we can consider doing there is, you scan the lecture 1 also and upload it along with your PAR 123. That can be done. The first of the clauses. See, I tell you before I get into the first clause. There are 9 clauses in this 240, which we have to certify. Right? I heard a lot of people tell me saying, VAT audit, it's a summary of all the VAT average that the dealer has filed for the 20 months. Is that true? Is that right?
Not at all.
Not at all. So, the way I communicate this, it's a little blunt, right? So I keep telling people saying, look, your audit does not start with 500, nor does it end with that, right? So don't bother if you are doing a summary of the 500 and populating it here and sending it out. Why? Because when we start reading the clause, what really the clause asks you to certify, rather all of us to certify, is, have all the transactions which the dealer has executed during the year, have they been reported in form VAT 100, which is your monthly return. So, if you are summarizing VAT 100 and calling it a 240, then I think it's incorrect. Right? Because the task here is to verify 100 and comment on that. Not to summarize the 100 and submit it as a report. So, we should be sensitive to that one aspect. 100 may be right, the VAT 100 that is fine, maybe perfectly, arithmetically, legally, everything is fine with that. Still, it does not mean that you take a summary of that and, you start your audit with that. The first of the clauses, which is the books of account and other related records in the register maintained by the dealer are sufficient for the verification of the correctness and completeness of the returns filed for the year. It sounds a very regular, routine clause when we look at so many audit reports, right? But there are few words which are very subjective here. Okay, it says other relevant records. These other miscellaneous, residuary are generally very dangerous. Right? So what does other
relevant records mean?
Books of account. We know what books of account is.
Fine, fair enough.
So what are other related records? It would mean subsidiary ledger. Right? It should mean the statutory records which are maintained in some other law. It should mean any of them. One more word. It says sufficient or verification. Sufficient is a very dangerous word in my mind at least. What is sufficient for one? No. I don't think I really need to use slides here, so I just skip that. Right? So sufficient. What is sufficient for me is not sufficient for another person. Right? So how do you understand what sufficient is in this context? What is sufficient when you are doing an audit of Hindustan Unilever has a very different connotation when you are doing the audit of say a small private limited company which has a crore or 10 crore of turnover. Sufficient has got a very different connotation in both these situations. Right? So while it is subjective, I go with the belief that you should never read law in such a manner that it becomes nonsense. Right? Try and read the law, appreciate what the lawmaker really wants, though he may have used some wrong English here and there, or some subjective words, but appreciating why the law is, what the purpose of this report is, I think we should be sensitive to that and look at it in that manner. When you say sufficient, are the details sufficient for you to verify what is put in the return, what is indicated in the return? Because at the end of the day, the certificate revolves around what was disclosed in format under it, is it right? Is it correct? So are the books of accounts maintained in such a manner that you can extract all the details that are required for format under it? That is how we should really understand the meaning of sufficient here. Right? The next clause. The total turnover of sales declared in the return includes all the sales effected during the year. This is slightly dangerous. The total turnover of sales declared in the return include all the sales effected during the year. All the sales. No exception. It may be a sale of fixed assets. It also means that you need to understand what is time of sale under the VAT law. Right? Because lot of times what happens? Quarter end, year end, there are a lot of things which happen. Right? You may have raised an invoice on 31st March, but you may have dispatched the goods on 1st of April. What is time of sale in such cases as far as VAT law is concerned, as far as the sales inquisitor, simple transfer of property in goods is concerned. Right? Transfer of ownership is when the sale is deemed to have taken place. Subject to your 30-day time limit, 14-day time limit, all those time limits are there. So we need to be sensitive in terms of especially goods in transit. Goods in transit on 31st of March, we need to be sensitive on that to see if that qualifies as a sale in the month of April or is it sale in the month of March. Because if it is March, though it is not recognized as a sale in the books of account, we have to recognize it as sale as far as 240 is concerned, as far as the VAT audit is concerned. The total turnover of purchases declared in the return include all the purchases made during the year. The booklet that is circulated I saw, it has all the slides, so maybe it is in the same order that we are going. The total turnover of purchases declared in the return include all the purchases made during the year. What is purchases? We purchase so many things. We purchase raw materials, we purchase traded goods, we purchase consumables, we purchase fuel, we purchase lubricants, we purchase stationery, we purchase electronic goods, we purchase furniture and fixtures, we purchase office equipment, a photocopier, we purchase biscuits and chocolates. So what is purchase? What is it that we really need to disclose as far as 100 is concerned? See, because the clause that what we are required to certify is very simple. Very simple phrase. It says the total turnover of purchases declared in the return includes all the purchases made during the year. All the purchases can include your stationery, can include your biscuits and chocolates also. Right? So what do we do? Is it purchase in the true nature as far as VAT law is concerned? It's a purchase, I agree. It's a purchase in the common market. But what is purchase in the context of VAT law? Right? So we need to borrow, we need to look at it a little more, you know, at a higher level. Not at a very ground level today what purchase is, you know. What is done, what is procured or purchased in the course of business is what is relevant for this quarter. The reference for this can be drawn in two ways, right? From a pure accounting point of view, when you purchase biscuits and chocolates, it's an expenditure. It is truly not a purchase from a trading or a manufacturing account point of view. One. Two, there are various purchases we make, and if you land up buying those goods, purchasing those goods from unregistered dealers, you are required to pay unregistered dealer tax, as if you are the seller of the goods. Right? So one, this is the second way of looking at it. If that transaction what we are talking about, assume it was purchased from an unregistered dealer, if you were liable to pay a purchase tax on that, which is unregistered dealer tax, then it will be safe to say that it is included with the meaning of purchase for the stock 4 or the stock 3. Right? So look at it that way. So keeping that in mind, your chocolates and biscuits, office equipment, those things really don't qualify as purchases. What has a direct nexus to your revenue generating activity, so long as those are recorded and reflected as purchases, it could be sufficient. The adjustment to the turnover of sales or purchases is based on the entries made in the books of account maintained in the year. What are these adjustments? Increase in selling price, decrease in selling price, which is typically an escalation or a discount, sales return. These are not adjustments. But one thing to notice, as far as clause 4 is concerned, sales returns will not be included here. Because sales return is specifically required to be commented upon for the next one, for the fifth one. Right? So as far as clause 4 is concerned, it typically should be understood to include your discounts, then escalation, price variation, those aspects. The next one is about sales return. The deduction from the total turnover, including deduction on account of sales return claim in the return, are in conformity with the provisions of law. Two aspects. We need to understand what is sales return, when is it allowable, and second is what are the disclosure requirements. Because you can't go away from one aspect here. We are required to comment on whether the disclosure in format 100 was right or wrong. Right? That is our single point agenda with whatever you are making. Right? So, what type of, what are the conditions for us to be able to claim a deduction towards sales return? Simple, within 6 months, goods should have been returned. You should have reversed the tax element also in that. You should have either paid back or received, depending on purchase return or sales return, the tax amount also. Fair. Those are the basic conditions as far as sales returns to be able to claim a deduction. But now, strangely, this has come to light only in the last 3 years. When am I supposed to claim a recredit of the tax that was paid on the original sales? I sell goods in May, I receive the goods back, sales return, in the month of June. So am I supposed to declare this transaction as sales return in the month of June, or is it in the month of April? April or May, whenever it was. In the month of sale or in the month of return? Our understanding has always been that because the law provides for a reduction, because the law provides for this transaction as a deduction, it implies, it is common parlance, common sense, to say that I will give effect to it in the month in which the return really took place, which is June or July. Irrespective of when I sold, so long as it is within 6 months. But we have Karnataka High Court, which is apparently held that the returns have to be disclosed in the month in which the sale took place. Which means what? I have to go back to April and revise the return. Right now, I have my own reservations on that thinking of the High Court. But as of today, unfortunately, we need to follow that. Unfortunately. It is our jurisdiction High Court, so we don't have much option. The law really says that the High Court has interpreted the sales return in such a manner that it says we should go back to the month in which the sale was made, remove this same transaction, because it is written in a subsequent period, and revise the return. Which there is logic in for them to say. Saying we give you 6 months time to be able to revise the return, 6 months coincide with the time limit that is given for sales returns to be allowed as a deduction. Right, wrong, operationally inconvenient, difficult, not possible, court is not bothered about that. Right? Court job is to interpret, and this is how it is interpreted. But yes, I personally believe, I have my own reservations on that. So what do we do? I have not come across more than five companies which actually do, in my experience. What about the others? What do we do as far as our audit is concerned? See, because you have to comply with law. We are certifying that the details that are disclosed in the returns are correct, not even proven fair. So if the sales reflects, if that sales return is reflected in June and not in April, then it is incorrect. The return of April is also incorrect, the return of June is also incorrect. What I believe we can do, because if give a note, and I personally believe it is sufficient so long as it is taken as a deduction in the month of June itself and don't have to revise the return for April.
This
change
happened in 2012. Yes. Okay. So if you
see the return, the 800, there is a specific column, sales which have been, sales which have been returned within 6 months.
Within
6 months.
There is a specific, I
don't know, any clause. Where you have to tell us, give effect to the tax. Precisely.
Where I'm coming
from is the thinking of the tax office is not, does not appreciate that law. They believe that you have to go back to the sale, the month in which the sale was made and revise that return. That's what I wanted to share. The next clause is the classification of goods sold, rate of tax applicable, and computation of the output tax and net tax payable as shown in the return is correct. Classification. We need to be sensitive to all these aspects. Classification is correct, rate of tax is correct, and the values are correct. Fine, fair enough. The next clause, the computation of classification of goods purchased, the amount of input tax paid and the deduction of input tax credit claimed in the return is correct and in conformity with the provisions of law. Classification of goods, understandable. Amount of input tax paid, understandable. Amount of deduction claimed, yes. That it is correct, understandable. Now what does computation of classification of goods mean? Right? The law says, we should certify that the computation of classification of goods purchased is correct. At least, to my knowledge, I have not been able to figure out what computation of classification means. Right? So, I have been assuming for the last 7 years now that it's a typographical error which is not there correctly. Right? The next one is, the utilization of statutory forms under the KRA Act 2003 and CST Act 1956 is for valid purposes. All these statutory forms received, issued, statutory forms received or statutory forms issued. As in, say, assume it's a form C. So, the clause that is required here is, what are we supposed to certify here? The forms that we have issued against interstate purchase or received against interstate sales. Which part of the C form are we required to certify here? The clause says, the utilization of statutory forms. So it's, yes. You know, I agree with that. It is more of the issue side, not of the receipt side. One more way of looking at it is, as far as these statutory forms are concerned, the onus of correct usage and the accuracy of the details is always in the person who is issuing it, not in the person receiving it. So that coincides with what we require to indicate here. One more thing. It is only Karnataka VAT Act 2003 and CST Act 1956. Entry tax, don't have to worry. Other information given in the return is correct and complete. Other information, so everything else that is there in the return, other than what we have discussed in the first 8 clause. What are these other? Some very basic things. Invoice number. What clause of the return which requires us to give the first tax invoice number of the month and last tax invoice of the invoice number of that month. It can be that. the person who is filing the return. See, this is something which I think a lot of errors are there. When we obtain the registration, we give the details of authorizing letter. After that, we forget that, you know, there is a change in the authorized signatory, therefore, the, see, what is the purpose of authorized signatory? So that he is the person who will communicate or attest all the documents which are filed with the department. One of the signatures is on the, say, VAT return, right? So you need to make sure the person who is authorized is actually the person signing the return also. One more, say work contract. I think you just had the discussion. Work contract, civil work contract, construction and sale of residential apartments. There's a value which these builders recover towards land. Right? Should we disclose the, is the value of land required to be disclosed in the return? See, what is to be disclosed is total turnover minus your deduction, which gives you the net taxable turnover. Is land part of total turnover? So, out of abundant caution, lot of us disclose value of land also in the return. So, at tomorrow there is an allegation saying it is undisclosed money that you receive from your customers. But technically, as a person certifying this 249, you are required to certify that all other details indicated in the return are correct. So, is the value that is disclosed, see, your net taxable turnover may be correct. Because you are including it in the total turnover and giving a deduction of an equivalent amount. So, your net amount is correct, your taxes are correct. But, is the value disclosed against that field which is called gross total turnover correct if you include lines? One. Say, other transaction, barter. Barter is not a sale at all. Right? If it is not a sale, then there is a question of it getting included in the total turnover also. So barter also, should it really be disclosed? Assuming you are able to identify value, give a value to it. Right? So out of abundant caution, we land up including all these in the return. So in those cases, what we can do is probably give a note to say that just for the limited purpose of disclosure, though it does not form part of total turnover, it is reflected in the return. Okay, the next is the table. I think it is self-explanatory. I don't see any questions on that, rather any issues on that, except one. In field number 5, it says any other item. The inference is any other item you can give at least how many ever you want. While in the hard copy that you go print and sign and give it to your dealer and your client and file it to the tax office if you are doing that, can have as many. The online when you are submitting it, unfortunately it provides only for 3. It provides only for 3. You cannot insert a 4th one. Which means what? If you land up giving more than 3 in your hard copy, the hard copy that is there versus what is there online can be different. So be sensitive to that one aspect.
Excuse me.
Yeah?
One doubt. Regarding entry taxes. You said it is not applicable in VAT 240. Since we are also certifying the data which is going to VAT 100, we are verifying the correctness and completeness of the returns. Since the entity tax also forms part of those returns, should we comment on the entity tax not levied and they have to levy now?
See, personally, I want to believe that entity tax comments are not required. So what we can consider doing there is even not saying our review and the, you know, the disclosure that we made in 240 limited to the extent of VAT and GST. Personally. Because there is no concept of audit that is there under that law item. And these provisions are not applicable to, are not made applicable to the entry tax law. The next part of the audit report, rather format 240, we have 3 parts in this. 1, 2, and 3. The first one is general information, second one is about turnover, third one is about more or less utilization of the forms and various documents. Right? You want us to, you want to discuss each of these forms in detail or do I take up only the issues that come out there? Which is what I have done in these slides also. Sorry, I corrected next time, I have not given numbers to the slides. Yeah. So these are the 3 parts that we are talking about. right? There are concerns as far as couple of clauses are concerned, rather quite a few, right? So I thought we can discuss them rather than talking about what do we write as far as name of dealer is concerned or status of that person is concerned. Is that okay? Right. You know, there is one which is called clause 5, which says full address of all additional places of business in the state, and then full address of all additional places of business outside the state. Inside the state, we can still understand. By any chance, if the dealer is not registered, he has a place of business, but it is not registered, are we required to comment on that? Yes. Because we are covering all the transactions as far as the state of Karnataka is concerned. What if we have a place of business outside the state which is not registered? Should we comment on that? I think we can limit our discussion as far as the state of Karnataka is concerned. And if there are any registered places outside the state of Karnataka is concerned, we can list them down here. Address of any branch or unit in the state having a different registration number. This is typically allowed only with the permission of the commissioner, where he specifically made an application to him and obtained a separate thing for another location within the state. This would be applicable only in such cases. 47, section 47. Description of 10 major goods sold. What does major really mean? Value, volume, it can be any of them. Right? So, whichever is more appropriate for that dealer that we are talking about, for that company that we are talking about, we need to disclose those top 10 goods. What about work contracts? If we are executing work contracts, say construction, should we disclose it as brick, cement, sandstone, granite, marble, etc.? No. It would be sufficient so long as we say that it is a developer engaged in construction activity, construction in trade of say residential apartments. Clause 10. Whether permitted under special accounting scheme or not. This would apply only to retailers where specifically permitted by the jurisdictional joint commissioner or commissioner in certain cases. So only in those cases, not applicable to anybody else. I think by and large, the part 1 is fairly light. Other details are, you know, books of accounts that are maintained, list of books of accounts examined, method of valuation of opening and closing stock. Unless there are questions, you please may raise those. The part 2. The first of the clauses there says total taxable turnover. What does total turnover and taxable turnover mean? Computed in terms of the definition given under section 2, reduced rule 3, fine. Total turnover. Does it include value of land? Does it include barter? Does it include warranty? Does it include services? See, on the abundant caution, again, we land up including these as part of total, showing it as a deductible item. Your next turnover is going to be the same. Next taxable turnover will always remain the same. There will be no change to that. But do these really form part of total turnover? If not, then there is no question of including that. And if it has been included, repeat at the cost of repetition, out of abundant caution, so that we are not penalized for non-disclosure of a transaction tomorrow. I think you can let that go. Frankly, it has no tax implications or a disclosure implication. Can give a note to say only for the limited purpose of disclosure against this name that amount is included, otherwise it does, in terms of rule 3.2, it does not form part of the taxable or total turnover of the deduction of debt. Deduction claims under Karnataka Act 2003 specify in respect of each deduction its nature and whether it is in order and supported by the prescribed documents. Same returns is one of the deductions that we claim there. Right? I'll give you one example, maybe hypothetical also. Say there's a developer. The construction has begun. We are waiting for plan sanction. Right? But we know that basic construction can begin. Say our plan is to construct, ground plus 25 floors. by the time the transaction comes, you get it only for ground plus 20. You have received the money for somebody who has booked 21st, 22nd and 23rd floor. One. Second situation. You have got the approval to construct all the 23rd. But subsequently there is an objection which has come because of which they have approved only 15th. Right? This has happened beyond 6 months. Beyond 6 months from the date you receive the money from the customer, from your client or customer, this has happened. So should that form part of a deduction? Is that a deductible amount? Will that be sales return?
Unfortified sales.
So how do we disclose that? Should it get excluded as part of total turnover, or should we include it in total turnover and show it as a deduction?
Show it as a
deduction, I mean. Fair enough. But how do we disclose that? There is no deduction for this under 3.2. Franchise. Right? While legally, there is a school of thought which, based on which we can say that it does not form part of total turnover at all. But again, for keeping it transparent, we can always be, I think we should include it as part of total turnover and use it in the deduction. These are the taxable sales within the state. It asks for description of goods, taxable turnover, rate of tax, and tax payment. Two comments on this. One is, I have seen a lot of us do in description of goods. We say goods taxable at 4%, goods taxable at 5.5%, goods taxable at 14.5%. Is that description of goods? That is our way of classifying for whatever reason is best known to us. Right? That in no stretch of imagination actually means description of goods. The rate of tax which is required in the next term, right? So be careful about that, because I've seen a lot of us do that. The next comment on this. It asks for rate of tax and tax payable. It doesn't ask for tax collected. It doesn't ask for tax collected. So does that mean anything at all? From our, see, all of us, you know, when we write exams or when we do other audit work, we better have checks and balances. Right? So that if something is wrong, it should get highlighted in some other process. Right? So tax collected versus tax payable, does it mean anything at all to us? One thing is, in the previous clause, tax collected should be disclosed as a deduction. So you can make sure that the amount collected which is claimed as a deduction under clause 2 is equivalent of tax payable indicated under clause 3. If there is a mismatch between the two, what does it mean? If the tax collected is lower, can't do much. Tough luck for the dealer. Right? If tax collected is higher, it cannot be retained. It has to be paid. It is something which will be forfeited. You cannot collect tax and keep it for yourself. Except to the extent that you can rightfully do because of a deduction or a input tax credit. Otherwise, no. That should be forfeited. And yes, it is our responsibility to commit saying it is liable to forfeiture also. Wherever tax collected is higher than what is paid. Details of purchases and other receipts. Total value of purchases and receipts. The first, the heading of that clause, it asks for total value of purchases and receipts. Now what is value? Is it the value indicated in the purchase invoice? Is it the cost which you record as cost of purchase in your books, including your freight and landing and whatever other expenditures that you incur? What is the value in this case? One more step ahead. If it is import, what is the value that you indicate? Whether it is the bill of entry value, which gives you in rupees, or is it the accounting value? Right? So, while there is no there is nothing which prescribes what needs to be disclosed here, I think it should be consistent what we do. One thing that can be very safely done. See, the purpose of asking this also has to be appreciated. Only then we can disclose what is really required. The reason why purchases are asked here is to be able to identify if policy is appropriately used, input tax credits are rightly claimed. Right? So if you link that, it is, I think it is correct to disclose the invoice only, because that is what will match with the subsequent policy that you issue in case of interest rate purchases and subsequent input tax credits that you will utilize in the subsequent clause. Details of purchases and other receipts. It says imports, interstate purchase, interstate stock transfers, purchases from registered dealer. First three are very simple. Purchases from registered dealer. This registered dealer concept is a never-ending unit when it comes to input tax credits. The day I purchase, you are registered. The day you do the audit, he is deregistered. So, should you disclose that purchase against purchase from registered dealers or purchase from unregistered dealers? It is logical to say it is purchase from registered dealers because on the day of purchase you are registered. But, superimpose the thinking of the department on this. Okay? They go on 10 steps ahead. Not when you are doing the audit. At least audit has a timeline. You have to complete it within 31st December of the next year, of that year and file it. Right? So the time gap is reasonable. Just take the case when they pick it up for assessment or reassessment. That day after 2 years, after 3 years, after 4 years. On that day, if the dealer is deregistered, the input tax credit is disallowed. Right now is not the discussion I am trying to highlight here. It is wrong. It is definitely wrong to call in disallow the input tax credit. But that is the thinking of the department. After 4 years, I am doing the audit of one of the companies. On that day, the supplier is deregistered or blacklisted, etc. There is no reason why it should be disallowed unless the department is able to prove that on the day I purchased, he was deregistered and the invoice was fraudulently issued. Right? So, never mind. It is important to understand on the day of the purchase what was the status. Accordingly, we should disclose the details here. Purchase from unregistered dealer with the state. Unregistered dealer purchase? Yes. Again, as we spoke in the beginning, only those goods which are purchased in the course of business is what we need to consider here. Not printing and stationery, your office equipment, your fax machine, or any of those. Chocolates and biscuits? No, not those. Any raw materials, consumables, lubricants. Anything which has a direct access to the business or the revenue generating activity is what we need to consider here. One of the support for this is one of the recent judgments, 71 BST Baltimore Plantation case. So it explains what is in the course of business for the purpose of URD purchases. Details of input tax, sorry, one more question on this. Details of purchase and other receipts. What is asked for here are only imports, interstate purchase, interstate stock transfer, purchase from registered dealers, unregistered dealers. Only five. What about job work? If you receive goods on job work, are we required to disclose here? Two, if you receive goods on loan basis. On import transactions, there are a lot of cases where you receive goods on loan basis. Should we disclose those here? Again, it goes back to what he asked a question here. From an entry tax point of view. If you want to advise the entry tax, yes, if there is a machinery which has come, whether it is free of charge or loan, all that doesn't matter. If you cause entry of those goods into the local area, then I will do the entry tax. Right? But since at least our understanding is that we limit our observations as far as VAT and CST is concerned, we don't need to bother about entry tax. So loan basis, then free of cost receipts or job work. According to my knowledge, it may not be required to be disclosed here. Details of input tax paid on purchases. Description of goods. Again, description of goods. What is description of goods? In the sales, it is not 4%, 5%, etc. In case of purchase, what do we do? As far as description is concerned, we have a very a good habit of classifying that as raw materials, consumables, capital goods. Unfortunately, that is not description according to me. I mean, call it iron and steel, call it petroleum products, call it fuel, call it plastic, whatever that is. I believe that is more appropriately, we can call it as description of goods and not raw materials, capital goods, semi-finished goods. That is frankly not description of goods for this purpose. this coincides with the next what we need to disclose there, which is taxable turnover, coincides with what we spoke earlier. The value of purchases that we need to disclose in the previous class should tie up with this, where we call it taxable turnover. Sir, how much of time do I have? Okay. Deepak is here, my IT input that way. Right? So in the next class, details of input tax paid on purchases ineligible for deduction. One very important thing. First, it should qualify as input. Then it should be disallowable under section 11. Only then we need to disclose it here, not otherwise. Table, chair, furniture, office equipment, they don't qualify as input at all. Right? So don't have to disclose it here. That way. Chocolates and biscuits, the material that is used for housekeeping purposes, all that need not be disclosed. Clause 8. Clause 8, frankly, it's a very big challenge. Details of input tax deduction claimed on purchases relating to interstate sales and export sales. How do we ascertain? How do we ascertain? See, all these clauses that we spoke about, all this why? Somewhere, we know the purpose. That purpose as to why that information is being sought for, right? To verify whether the taxes paid are correct, to verify whether the deductions claimed are appropriate, those reasons. But what about clause 8? What is the purpose of clause 8? Because once you understand the purpose, disclosing the relevant details becomes easier. I think a lot of them, you know, raise this question but end up concluding in their minds. I don't know what happens in the audit report, but in their minds. Is not applicable or not relevant. I mean, if it was, if it can be dismissed so easily, then I don't think even the department would have asked for it. Right? Read it very carefully. It says, details of input tax deduction claimed on purchases relating to interstate sales and exports. We are not required to maintain as to which input goes into output which is locally sold, and output which is sold interstate, and output which is sold as an export. So how do we disclose this? See, when VAT was introduced 2005, there was a commitment, there was a promise from the central government saying they will reimburse the loss that the state government will incur because the state government has to give a credit of the input tax and allow that to be adjusted against the CST that is payable. Right? This was a commitment, this was a promise from the central government. 2005. There have been a lot of claims which various state governments have filed also. Partly the money that we received as well. So, in my view, that is the purpose of this clause. To say how much has the state government lost because of giving an input tax credit, because of allowing adjustment of input tax against the CST that is payable by them. So, how do you determine this? In a tree format, total input tax eligible for the month is say 1 lakh rupees. My output tax comprises of two taxes, which is VAT and CST. VAT is say 40,000, CST is say some 80,000. 1 lakh 20 is my output tax, 1 lakh is my input tax, so I'll end up paying 20,000 to the government this month. So now in this, how do you say how much is utilized towards the CST? VAT has to be first set off against 1 lakh. So you have 60,000 which you can actually utilize for payment of CST. So that is the amount which should really be disclosed here on a month-on-month basis, of course. The purpose is basically only that commitment of the central government. There is no other purpose behind this. Details of unadjusted excess input tax credits carried forward from the previous year and to the next year, which is basically unutilized amount brought forward, unutilized amount carried forward. Two amounts that you need to indicate. Now, as part of your audit last year, say for 12-13, the carry forward amount that was there in the return was 1.5 lakhs. Whereas on audit, you discovered some error, you finally concluded and issued a report which said the amount is not 1.5 lakhs, it is 1,35,000. Right? So what is the amount that you need to disclose as opening balance which is remaining unutilized here? Is it 135 or 150? 135. But in the return, it will continue as 1.5 lakhs. Because by the time the VAT audit is completed and you give him a chance to file the revised return, the 6 months would have lapsed. So there is no way that he'll be able to correct the opening balance in April of 13. Right? In April of 13, he will never be able to correct that opening balance. I have a 240. I am that company. I have a 240 which says 1,35,000 is my eligible carry forward. Whereas my return for the next month shows 1.5 lakhs. So what we can consider doing is two things here. One is you consider 1,35,000 which is the right amount as per 240 and given what, so that it is better understood by the reader of the report. Alternatively, you continue showing 1.5 lakhs as the carry forward and this 15 lakhs as payable. Which means what? 1.5 lakhs is likely carrying forward from March to April. This 15,000 of error which was noticed, not making the dealer pay, which is fine. One more view to support that is, unlike in income tax or service tax or central excise for that matter, in VAT, what in VAT and CST, what happens is, it is not the same officer or same office which does your assessment or reassessment for all the years. There is one team which does for 1 year, there is another team which does for the next year. Right? And be rest assured, this is an unpaid, problem. It is not a legal issue. Legally it is correct what we discussed, but unpaid reality is, if it is a transaction, if it's an adjustment which relates to other year, right? The officer doing the audit for the other year will not allow that. In other words, I am not doing the audit for that year, so I don't know the correctness of that. Right? So keeping this also in mind from a practical application of law point of view, it makes sense to carry forward 150 in that example that we took and as we discharge that 15,000. Take the reverse. Suppose it is 150 and for whatever reason you discover it should be 160. What about the 10? Claim it as a refund. That will be simpler from an operational point of view. The next one. Total and taxable turnover under the CST. What is taxable turnover under CST? You know, the value on which you are liable to pay the central sales tax, whether it is true or good rate of tax, whatever is that turnover. But what about total turnover? What is total turnover for the purpose of CST? Does it include your local, turnover which is liable to tax under the Karnataka VAT Act, which is local state? Abundant caution we disclose. Right? Abundant caution gets misused a lot of times. Now, assume that you will indicate the local sale turnover as part of the total turnover under CST, show it as a reduction in the next year. Then why not disclose turnover of all other states in the country? You got the difference there? Abundant caution, we said let's include the local turnover in the state of Karnataka and claim it as a deduction. Then why not the sale that has taken place, local sale in Gujarat, Delhi, Kashmir, Kerala, Tamil Nadu, all those states? Right? So, according to me, the local turnover also need not be included as part of total turnover for this clause. Deductions again, we have discussed that. Details of taxable sales, same observation, please be sensitive to description of the goods which are sold. If the dealer has opted for composition, indicated type, fair enough. Amount paid, yes. Rate, yes. There is one more word. The clause ends with a word called basis. What is basis of composition? It says, if the dealer has opted for composition, indicate the type of the composition scheme which is opted, and details of the composition, amount paid, its rate, and the basis. Basis is technically the value on which it is paid. Nothing else. The next one is fine, which is basically the summary of all the returns that have been filed during the year, including the revised returns. Then next one. Details of inspection of the business premises or books account of the dealer by the departmental authority on inspection or visit. So what is it that we have to disclose here? Is it the inspection or the visit, say 13-14 is the year we are talking about. April 13 to March 14. What are we required to disclose here? Is it the audit or the inspection which took place for the year 13-14 or during the year 13-14. During the year 13-14, it took place for 11-12 also. 10-11 also. Should we disclose that? Or should we disclose the auditor inspection which took place for the year 13-14, though it has happened after April? Obviously, it would have happened after April. So, what should we disclose here? Here then. You know, the idea of this is to see if there has been verification of any records by any officer. Right? So, I think we should disclose all the auditor inspections which have taken place during that and not necessarily for that entry. There's a note here below part 2 which says trading account in respect of each class of goods and manufacturing account in respect of each class of goods, whether taxable or not, along with accounting ratios on sales and other non-trade transactions, etc. Each class of goods. What is each class of goods? There is no science to this. It is specific to the business that is taking place. You may call everything as, you know, like adventure gear, footwear, wearing apparel. It can be anything of those, right? Some reasonable congruence should be there to call them as a class of goods, and that is how we need to consume. What are the ratios? Again, there is no mention of what ratio to be done, but commonly whatever is required, say sales turnover ratio, debtor turnover, whatever those turnover ratios can be furnished here. Particulars of declarations and certificates. This is part 3. The first two clauses, it talks about all the transactions as a sales, where you receive, where details of sales as commission agent, details of purchases as commission agent. So now again, a similar question like the previous one. Is it where I have appointed a sales commission agent, or is it a case where I have acted as a sales commission agent? What is it that we are required to disclose here? Where I have functioned as a sales commission agent, say for Hindustan Lever, or where I have appointed a sales commission agent for my product? It is the first one. It is where we have functioned as a sales commission agent. Because that is where the form that he is talking about comes into play. We need to be careful about this. I skipped clause 3 and 4. Fifth one. It says, stock of declaration or certificates used in CSC Act 1956, which is Form 3 E1 into F&H. Is it receipt of Form 3 from the customer or issue of Form 3 to our supplier? It is the second one. You should disclose the issue of Form 3 to our customers. So as far as one last comment as far as the 240 is concerned before I take up a couple of other issues. The last sentence of the form 240 says, the other report enclosed to mine or our certificate is true and correct. We have referred to something called an annexure 1 quite a few times, wherever we wanted to make notes or wherever we wanted to give additional disclosure, right? You can refer to that annexure 1 here, technically, because in the first page, in the first part of the certificate, when you say it is subject to our observations and comments about non-compliance, etc., etc., the online filing of 240 does not allow you to include annexure 1 there. So you can consider it, consider including it at this place, subject to your reproduce the same language and say as an annexure 1. Deepak, I'll take 5 minutes. Couple of things as far as issues are concerned in 240. One is purchases. One is purchases. You know, you go back to clause 4 of the certificate, sorry, clause 3 of the certificate. It says total turnover of purchases declared in the return include all the purchases made during the year. You never know. At times, your sample may not really be able to identify whether all the purchases have been recorded appropriately. Not that there are undisclosed or unaccounted purchases. It may have gone into an account which is not a purchase entry, because of which it may not get listed in your so-called purchase register. So what do you do? Right? You can probably consider putting a note to say that, look, our review of purchases is limited to the extent of saying, you know, the purchases in respect of which the dealer has claimed the credit in the return, whether they qualify as imports or not. something where the dealer himself has not checked the credit, you may not be able to identify at all. You may not be able to identify because it will not even get listed in the purchase register. Quite a possible situation that it may not get listed in your purchase register. In such cases, you could consider inserting this note. Deepak will talk about it, so I just raise this as a question. Partial rebate and special rebate. Value of stock transfer. What is the value that we should take? Right? Here, in one of the clauses where we say details of purchases, sorry, details of the sales and per detail. Stock transfer is one of the deductions under 3.2. What is the value of such stock transfer? You should be careful about that. And yes, rightly, please give a note to say that our review is limited to VAT and CSC unless you are covering the entry tax part of it also. Time of sale is one thing that you should be careful about for year end or quarter end or month end transactions. We have another Karnataka High Court judgment which says if you, 6 months is reasonable enough time for you to claim the input tax credit. If you don't, it is gone. One. Two. The second analogy which comes out of that judgment. You should claim the input tax credit in the month in which the sales invoice by the seller was issued. He will issue an invoice on 15th April. You would receive the goods on 21st April. You would record it on 28th April. Fair enough. You have taken the credit in the same month. Though not on the same day, you have taken it in the same month, which is fair. What about a dispatch of goods by your supplier on 28th of April? You will receive the goods on 2nd of May. Assuming you are a 6 week month, you will account for that purchase and take the credit also on 2nd of May. Without any gain. But still, it is a transaction which you record as purchase and claim credit on that in the month of May, right? You will definitely not claim that as a purchase in the month of April. Else, you will have a qualification under another law saying, you know, even before the goods are received, this man is accounting purchase. Right? Because rightfully he received the goods only on 2nd May. But Centrum Industry says you should claim the credit in April. Because the invoice date is April. So what do we do for this? Again, I respectfully disagree with that analogy of the High Court. So what you can consider doing is, you can give a note to say that look, there is a timeline which is comfortably informed. It has no impact as far as the tax law is concerned. Because again, I want to believe that at least that Deepak may agree with me because we have discussed on this earlier. The Centrum Industry is a badly argued case. It is not that the judgment is wrong, but I think it was badly argued, more than anything else. The documentation that is available in case of input tax credit signed, other deductions that you claim should be verified. Original invoices, no photocopies please. It should have those disclosures which are basic for you to call it as a tax invoice. Two, subcontracts, wherever you are claiming a deduction. You have to have those certificates on record from the subcontractor which gives you an equivalent of saying that I have declared such and such an amount of turnover in such and such a month and I have paid tax on that. Those certificates are mandatory. Without which deduction, it is right to disallow the deduction under law. E-sumam.
So, electronic invoice, digitally signed, will that be valid or?
I would say yes. So long as it is signed in terms of the IT Act 2000. See, all of us misunderstand digital signature. You know, I scan my signature, put it in that, convert it into a PDF. I am sorry, that is not digitally signed.
But you have got
a token. Yes, that is digital
signature.
That's valid. That's perfectly. Ease of verification. I understood this problem recently though. I believe ease of report can be generated only for 10 days at a stretch. Okay? So if that client of yours has not generated ease of report regularly at every 10 days and consolidated that, then for your verification, he has to generate 36 reports.
365 days a year. So 37 reports you have to generate. Consolidate that and give it to you. I believe this is a problem. I was not aware of this thing recently. But yes, that verification I believe is required. Because that is one of the aspects that is very important as far as to observe compliance with under the backup. Whether all the movements, whether inward or outward are covered by each of them as required. There are some questions which,
How do you verify the ESOM, whether it is
non-compliant? Whether it is?
Whether it is for the purpose, how do you verify
it? See, in the ESOM there is a purpose that is input, which is required to be put there. See, there are two ways of reconciliation. One is from a quantity or number of forms point of view, the other is from a value point of view. Right? I would approach this reconciliation first from a number point of view. Say I have used some 1500 ESOMs in the whole of the year. Right? How much of it has been cancelled? Follow the deductive principle in doing the reconciliation. First, every which is cancelled. Right now does not matter. As far as the system will say that it is cancelled, which means I have not used. Now, out of the use, first tree structure. Classify it into how much is for inward movement, how much is for outward movement. Right? Inward movement is only to observe the compliance. Whether I have used any ESOM to bring the goods into my premises. Value is really not relevant here. Really. The second part of it, which is relating to dispatching, that is where the value is important. Because as an officer, see, everything has a purpose. The purpose of doing the ESOM reconciliation is what? To ensure that the value, there is no sale which is gone undeclared. So, the purchase part of it, so long as the numbers are there and utilized rightly, it is fine. The sales part of it alone, it is sufficient if you are able to reconcile it with the value of sales that is discounted. See, like all your dispatches, it will be stock transfer or it will be sales. Right? Very few others, like job work, etc., etc. So, classify this. All these dispatches anyway have to be reflected from a value perspective in the return. Right? So, if I say that, look, out of that 1,325 are for sales. Does the value indicated in those 325 ESOM compare with the value of sales that are declared in my 100? That is sufficient. Right? So, if we try to do value and number for both, I think it is meaningless because there is no purpose at it, sir. So, first, reconcile based on numbers, follow the deductive principle. For purchases, so long as numbers are matched, it is fine. For sales, we have to match the value. There are some other questions which I come across which is part of the slide. I don't want to take more time of Deepak. We can chat on that separately also. Anything? Any questions? Do let me know. These are the issues which I thought I should really share as far as that audit is concerned. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Thanks a lot. Just a minute before the tea. Tea is still not ready. Thanks a lot to my good friend Nina Bhadina for thinking of a topic, especially post-marriage and making it so interesting. In actually only I was not there at all, but I was here with some outside. We are talking about two things because we are finding some other arrangements also and take what you are speaking also. So, you know exactly what you are speaking on and such an extremely nice way to illustrate of particularly how you should go about in terms of the area which is actually the core of an audit. Thank you very much, Ms. Bhadina, for the tremendous work you have done on this. And great that as part of the research team, but we have Deepak Kumar Jain is there. Deepak is another very bright, young and very energetic person. Lot of material in terms of content and delivery. Deepak will be the next speaker. And before we get into the next session, please be ready. I would like you people to assemble back as soon as possible. So that now we would like to have the session of Deepak also. Extending till such time you have the pages like yesterday. So with this I would like to invite Mr. Srishtar Patel to come over and hand over a moment to our resource person, Mr. Rinat. Thank both to Mr. Rinat Bhatinath as well as Mr. Srishtar Patel for joining us. And for each one of you for taking me today, making this a very interesting and useful session, please actually ready. Thank you.